down and leave it there.
I was down with no way up, and I needed some help. Everybody breathing but not living, just existing. Well, and I needed some help. Somebody told me that Jesus will set you free. I tried it for myself, and now I know what he did for me.
Hello, I am Pastor James Allen Dunkins. I'm the senior pastor of Shiloh Baptist Church, one church in two locations. I am so glad you decided to join us. Check out our program. Check out our viral worship. Check out our church in general. There are a lot of great things happening in Shiloh. Please go to our website and see some of the great activities that we are doing here in our area. Some of the things that we are doing to reach people for Christ. We are a kingdom church who believes in kingdom building, who is helping to change people's lives. Check out the message today. Go to our website. Check out our other messages. We are so glad to make you a friend of Shiloh Baptist Church. God bless you. This is Pastor Duncan saying, have a blessed day.
While on others thou art
Chains today. All right, so this is a day the Lord has made. I'm Pastor Duncan. If you you like our ministry, go check like, let somebody else know it's on, and you know, just share this ministry with someone, and we're just so appreciative. But right now, I want to get to the Word of God. So I want you to grab your devices, your Bibles, as you are home. It is a word that I feel rattling in my spirit right now that God wants to set somebody free. Go to 1 Kings chapter 17. 1 Kings chapter 17. When you have it, say amen. Amen. There's a word there. Turn me down just a little bit. 1 Kings chapter 17. We're going to begin reading at verse 8. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. So he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, indeed a widow was there gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. So she said, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in the bin and a little oil in the jar. And see, I'm gathering a couple of sticks that I may go and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat and die. And Elisha said unto her, do not fear. Go and do as you have said, but make me a small cake from it first and bring it to me, and afterward make some for yourself and for your son. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. So she went away and did according to the word of Elisha, and she and he and her household ate for many days. The bin of the flour was not used up, nor did the jar of all oil run out or run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which was spoken by Elisha. Come on, I need you to cover me in prayer right now. Father God, by your own anointed will, I need you to bless me, Lord, in the delivery of this word, that you have this catered or made especially for someone there. Right now, God, allow me not to get in the way. Allow me, Lord, to allow the anointing, the Holy Spirit, to flow through this place so someone can be set free. And I thank you right now in advance for what you're going to do, God. Amen. For as long as the Spirit of the Lord will allow, I'm going to speak from the thought. God has more than enough. I'll say it again so it can sink in your spirit. God has more than enough. Jessica Cox is a fireball of passion and power and unstoppable energy. She is not afraid to tackle any challenge, and at the age of 37, she has been successful with everything she has tried to do, and she's done a lot. She is an accomplished surfer, a scuba diver, a black belt in Taekwondo. She's a dancer, she's a swimmer, and she's a musician, and her last accomplishment was so remarkable because she, at the 37 years old, is a female pilot. Now, you might not be too impressed with Jessica just hearing what I'm telling you now, but when I give you the rest of the story, you'll understand why she is such an anomaly. You see, with all those things I just told you, Jessica Cox is armless. That's right. She was born with no arms. Everything she does, she does with her feet. She accomplished all that stuff I told you. When she was born, Jessica herself said there was no reason why. They couldn't find a genetic reason why she didn't have arms. Her siblings are all fine. But soon as she came out of the womb, she came out with
with power, so much so that her parents enrolled her in a public school. And in public school, she had an I can do anything anybody else can do attitude. And the reality is, she was better than everyone else. For about 11 years, she wore prosthetic arms. But she said, I never took to those. And she said, I found out that I could do what I needed to do with my feet. You know what's really remarkable about Jessica? She's done more with no arms than most people who are born whole have done in their entire life. And she has not ever once back down from any challenge. What am I saying? She's in the Guinness Book of World Records for two things. First, she's the only armless person with a black belt in Taekwondo. She's the first and only armless person to have their own plane and their own pilot's license. When you ask Jessica what happened, how did she get like that? Jessica says, I lead a no excuses kind of life. Come on, stay with me for a minute. She said, I make sure that I can accomplish or I can fight through anything I have to go through. But there are two main reasons, two foundational principles that uphold Jessica. Here's what you need to know, and I know it was no secret when I started telling you about her, but she is a motivational speaker, and Jessica says the first thing is her faith in God, and the second thing is her belief that with God on her side, she can do anything. Look at her bio. In her bio about her faith in God, she says, when you just go out to see her, she says, my name is Jessica Cox. My faith in God is my continual stabilization. It's the force in my life that has helped me overcome numerous challenges. I literally don't know where I would be without God. Second, she says, I genuinely believe that with God on my side, I have everything I need. I have more than I need, even though I don't have arms, to be successful and victorious in life. Let me stop right there. Let me bring you in where me and Jessica is. That's what this message is about. Why would I start off with Jessica Cox, who's a motivational speaker, who is armless, who has accomplished all this stuff to lead you? Because I want you to know the message God has for you is that there is no reason, watch this, every child of God, he wants you to see that there are no limits in God. You can have and do and accomplish anything in your life you want to accomplish. All you have to believe it, because God is the God who supplies more than enough. You need to understand that this text is tailored to teach you about the power of God. Somebody's sitting out there right now, and God is saying there's no need, even during this pandemic, for his children to be running around like they are helpless and hopeless, like they're worried about everything, just like the rest of the world. Why are you worried when we serve a God that has no limits to his power? We serve a God who's always on our side. We serve a God who's always giving us the victory. You know what I'm saying? Listen to Jeremiah. He has the resources and the abilities to do what he needs to do. Jeremiah, the weeping prophet of God, the one who was warning the people about the power of God, the one who said God was like a fire shut up in my bones. In that 32nd chapter with the 17th verse, Jeremiah had got a little discouraged because after the people went into bondage, he didn't believe or didn't know or didn't understand that God had enough power to get them out of bondage. And he was in the middle of prayer and weeping when all of a sudden the Holy Spirit grabbed him and shook him like I wish God would do with some of us. He shook Jeremiah, and Jeremiah wrote this verse in the 17th verse of the 32nd chapter. Oh Lord God, behold! You have made the heavens and earth by your own hands and your great power. He said, there is nothing too hard for you. Jeremiah said, I was sitting there. God had been good in my life, but I had to remind myself. I'm just saying right here, somebody ought to remind themselves before I move further in this text how good God has already been in your life. This is not your first battle. This isn't the first time you've had to struggle. Quit acting like you don't have no help. You better lift your hands, feel the Holy Ghost shaking you, grabbing you like Jeremiah, reminding you how good God has been in your life. So even now, you need to understand that nothing is too hard for God. Mary picks this up. Mary Magdalene, you know the Holy Spirit came to her in the form of Gabriel, the archangel, and told her that she was going to have a child. And Mary sat there and said, how can this be, seeing that I don't know a man? And Gabriel, the archangel, told her three things that let her know God was able. The first thing he told her was that the Holy Spirit is going to overshadow you and you will be with child. The second thing he said is that child is going to be the Son of God. The third thing was even more astounding. He said, and your cousin Elizabeth is also pregnant and going to have a baby, even though she's past the childbearing age. Here is what Mary said. Here is what we should say. She said, let it be unto me as you have said. I love that. Here's what she's saying. When you get into a situation, Mary believed God. She, think about what she did. She didn't question God. She said, let it be unto me. I'm just telling you, if there's a promise that you found of God, and you're in need right now, you ought to do what Mary did and just say, let it be unto me, just like you said it would. I believe you, God. If you need healing, tell God. I found a promise that said, Lord, that you will heal me, that you are a healer. Let it be unto me, just like you said, because I believe it. Lord, I found a promise you will supply all my needs. Let it be unto me. Come on, call out your thing. You might tell God, I found out that you're a God of peace. You ought to tell God, let that peace be unto me, just like you promised. And then we got to move into, that was Luke chapter 1, verse 37. The archangel told her, for with God, nothing is impossible. I got so excited, I didn't give you the scripture. For God, there is nothing impossible. Luke 1, 37. And all I'm telling you is, we need to understand that there is nothing impossible with God. And the Apostle Paul brings it home for us in Colossians 1, 16. He was talking to the church at Colossae, and he said, he wants to show us that the reason God can be more than enough is because he's a sovereign God. Listen to that 16th verse of Colossians chapter 1. For in him were all things created that have been created in heaven and earth, visible and invisible, whether there be thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. So just in case you didn't understand, he said God created everything, whether it be powers or authority. That means he controls everything. And the psalmist lets us know in Psalms 115, verse 3, he says, but our God is in heaven. He does whatsoever he pleases. That just cleans it right up. God is in heaven. He does whatsoever he pleases. He is sovereign. He does what he wants, when he wants, how he wants, and to who he wants. You just have to grab it and believe it. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20 says, now unto him who is able. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that I ask or think, according to the power that works in me. Stop right there. The power has to be working in you. So God is a God who is sovereign. God is a God who can do the impossible. God is a God of more than enough. And that is what Elijah is teaching us in this text. We just have to trust God that we can be kept by faith. He's a God who not only can meet our need, he gives us more than we want. Go with me to the 14th verse of this first chapter. And that's where Elijah was talking to this poor widow. You know what Elijah told this widow? He had told her when he walked up on her, he said, first, I need you to go and give me a drop of water and make me a little cake. He said, I need you to go and make it for me first. She said, look, I don't have much. He said, no, make mine first. Make mine first. And then the oil and the meal will never run dry. Here's what he says. Get ready for this. The difference is when you trust God, just like Elisha said, the meal and the oil never ran out. I'm telling you right now, there's a power I'm getting ready to unleash in your spirit that lets you know my God is more than enough. What are you dealing with right now? You ought to tell yourself, that's right, talk to yourself, tell yourself, I got a God that's more than enough. Come on, don't front. Don't act like you've never been down in a situation where you had to bring yourself up. Somebody watching me right now had thought it was over, was ready to call it quits, but you need to tell yourself, I serve a God who has more than enough, and his M.O., his modus operandi, the way he functions, he loves. loves to make sure his children are taken care of. We're going to go into this text and we're going to find out some principles for tapping in the provision of God. How do we tap into the provision of God? I know you're sitting on pins and needles, but there's some principles that cover this text and all throughout scriptures, how we tap into the provision and power of God. If you got a need right now, you ought to follow me. The first reason we tap into the power of God and the provision of God is because God divinely commands the blessings. We have a divine command over the blessings. Don't forget that. The second reason that we can tap into the power of God is because we have a God who has a divine calculation that's not like ours. He calculates from a future perspective. He calculates from an omnipotent perspective. He calculates stuff that we never even thought we would have to need. We have a divine perspective of God commanding the blessings. We have a God who divinely calculates. And then God gives us a reason to have divine celebration. Are you ready? Let's go into this text right here. We found out that after the death of Solomon, David's son, who had run the kingdom. Remember, Solomon was supposed to be the wisest man that ever lived. And then we found out Solomon started out great. He went to God and asked God, said, can I have wisdom? After he got wisdom, he went out and built the temple of God that David wanted to build and couldn't build. But then Solomon's heart was turned from God. Watch out when you start getting stuck. He started marrying foreign women and foreign wives as political allegiances to try to keep Israel strong. Right there, he messed up. He forgot about God and started having foreign allegiances just to keep Israel strong. But then he also adopted their gods. Do you know you can't hang out with everybody and not act like they act? He adopted their gods. And when their gods came in, he had all of Israel worshiping and bowing down to their gods. And then Solomon died. Rehoboam, his son, came on the scene. He was worse than Solomon. Rehoboam actually wanted to make the taxes heavier because he wanted to have even more temples built. He wanted more money. He was more greedy even than Solomon had gotten. And then when he put extra taxes, there was a split. That's when we had a divided kingdom. We had Judah in the south with Jerusalem the capital, and we had Israel in the north with Samaria the capital, and Jeroboam took the hearts of the people. Now we're set up going into the book. The book of 1 and 2 Kings in our Bible are two books, but it was one book. The book of Kings is talking about how the idolatry and the disobedience and how God's people just went wild instead of trusting him and ended up into bondage. They ended up in a place where they were underneath the power of another nation. All I want you to know is God at this point didn't let them just end up there all by themselves. You know, when something happens in their life, we can't blame God, because here is where my text is going. He actually then raised up prophets, and two of the most powerful prophets God raised up was Elijah and Elisha, who succeeded him after Elijah with a J, then Elisha with an X. And these two prophets are non-writing prophets, but are some of the most prolific prophets God has. And Elisha came, and all we know about Elisha, the text says he was a Tishbite from the land of Gilead. All we know about Elisha is he popped on the scene with power. Now, I don't know about you, and I'm gonna keep going, but I want you to see this. Sometimes people look, and when they see blessings in your life, act like the blessings just got there. They didn't see your tears. They didn't see all those years you struggled. They didn't see that time you were crying. They didn't see the stuff you had to fight off. So what I need to tell somebody, even though Elisha just showed up, you do not show up on the scene with that kind of power that he has if you haven't been through something with God. And this text we see in the first verse of the 17th chapter, he was told to go tell Ahab the king. Let's stop right there. There were 20 kings in Israel and 20 kings in Judah, and all of them were evil kings. There was only about 8 good kings out of the lot. And that's what the books of Kings is about, telling how each one of these kings did evil in the sight of the Lord. And Ahab was the worst because he married a Canaanite woman called Jezebel. And when he married Jezebel, Jezebel actually built a temple for Baal and Ashtaroth and had the whole nation worshiping Baal, had priests and prophets everywhere. God sent Elisha into that. Follow me. That's where we went. So Elisha showed up, went inside the palace, told Ahab, there will be no rain or dew as the Lord my God lives until I say so. Until I speak again, there'll be no rain. Look at the first verse of the chapter. Here's what he was saying is, Baal was supposed to be the god of crops and the god of fertility. And you know, this was an agrarian society. They were saying the reason we're worshiping Baal is because Baal is the one that's bringing us all the stuff we have. And so God, look how God did. God showed up and said, as the Lord liveth, he said, I want you to know, Ahab, I allowed you to be king. You turned the hearts, people's hearts from me. But you know what? I'm going to show you that your God is not a God at all. There will be no rain. I thought Baal controlled the weather. There will be no dew. I thought Baal was in charge of the crops. And the whole land went into a famine. Here's what God is saying. Quit acting like you don't know I'm your source. There is no sure cure but God. I know I got a witness out there that if it had not been for God in your life, there'd have been no cure. I know I'm getting excited, but I think about all the stuff I tried before I tried God. There's no cure but God for sure. And he was saying, I'm going to do a play. There was the latter rain and the former rain, and then there was the dew. God said, I'm going to take all the water out. There was the two main sources were the rains and the dew. The dew was so thick in the Middle East that the dew was like water. You could wring it out of clothes and still have water. God said, there's not even going to be any dew. Then he sent Elisha to the brook Cherith and said, Elisha, I'm going to send you to a brook that I still got running. And what I want you to do down there, he said, you ain't got to worry about anything. I'm going to have the ravens come and feed you and take care of you. I said, wow. Think about something, guys. Ravens were a scavenger animal, a scavenger bird. Why would God allow ravens to bring meat and bread? I wish I could stop on this miracle. Think about what I'm telling you. Every morning, Elisha looked up and a bird brought meat and bread. And every night, a bird brought meat and bread. God had the birds feeding Elisha. And what I want you to know about that is these were scavenger birds, which lets me know this, that I don't have to worry because God will use the wealth of the unjust to take care of the just. God will use the wealth of the unsaved. He will make your enemies your footstool. He used these birds. Now, you know, there's one teaching out there that said he used the birds to show that God can use an unclean thing to bless a clean thing. But Elisha, if these unclean birds, ravens, that don't even care about their family, are commanded to feed the servants of God, I'm getting ready to send you on a task when you're going to stand in front of Baal, in front of Jezebel, in front of Ahab. And so I need you to know, if these birds can serve my people, you can surely serve my people. That's where we were. But then a famous song, you've all heard this sermon, the brook dried up. All of a sudden the mud and the brook dried up. Here's where we start. God said, Elisha, don't worry. I want you to go down to Zarephath. Follow me, y'all. Because there's a widow. The verse says, I commanded to bless you. That's a blessing. Because he said, I commanded this widow to bless you. Now, what I want you to know about the widow blessing him is, first of all, this is our first point. God commands divine blessings. He divinely commands blessings in our life. He said, I will set up a place of blessings. Can I stop there and tell somebody to get excited about this? Every blessing you have gotten in the past, this is shoutable, is not an accident. God planned and commanded the blessings in your life. You know why you can get excited that blessings are not an accident? It's because those blessings were set apart for you. What do you need right now? It's been set apart for you. Is there somebody out there strong enough to claim what I need right now? Because I believe that it has been set apart for me. Come on, start calling it. You need a blessing on your children. You need a blessing on your finances. You need a blessing in your mind. All you have to do is say, God, since you command the blessings, I know you commanded one out there for me. The first thing you need to understand is he sent him to a widow. A widow was the poorest person there was. A widow in biblical times was only, her only way of being taken care of was by her husband. She must have recently been widowed because she had a small son. How do I know she had a small son? Because she was out gathering sticks. So that means she had no one to supply her with a living, and yet
God sent Elisha there because I believe that not only was Elisha going to get a blessing, watch me, he's going to be a blessing. Oh, come on, get excited right there. Here's what God does. Anytime you want to be a blessing, you will get a blessing. I believe he set apart a blessing for this woman because somewhere along the line, this woman must have found out about the God of Israel, because when Elijah approached her, she says, as your God liveth, as surely as your God liveth. So that means she had heard about the God of Israel. So I want you to take a look at this. And all of a sudden, God had set apart a blessing for her. Now, don't think this is light, because if you go to Luke's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 25 and 26, Jesus walked into the temple. You know the story. And as was his custom, he came back home after coming out of the wilderness. And when he got to the temple, he read that scripture and said, today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. And then all of a sudden, all of his own hometown folk said, don't we know him? Isn't Joseph his father? Don't we know his sisters and brothers? And Jesus had to let them know, you mess it up. I have prepared a blessing for you. I came and you didn't understand that. And he said, what are you talking about? That the next verse Jesus said in Luke 4, when he started talking to his hometown people, when they were all complaining about, they were all saying, we reject you and you can't be a Messiah. How is this fulfilled? Jesus told them in verse 25 and verse 26, you know what he said? But I tell you truly, watch this, y'all. This will mess you up. Many widows were in Israel in the days of Elisha when the heaven was shut up for 3 years and 6 months. There was a great famine that went throughout the land, but none of those widows did he go to, Elisha, except the widow of Zarephath. Did you get that? What he was telling them is they got angry because they were thinking there was something special. But here's what I need you to know. I don't care what another person looks like. I don't care what you're going through. Here is the shout for you. God said, I command blessings in your life, even when you don't know the blessings are coming in your life. And he set apart a blessing for you. Look at this poor Zidonian Gentile woman was not a Jew. Some Jewish widows died. But God said, for whatever reason, because he's sovereign, he said, this widow is going to live. I need you to know that God commanded the blessing because he told Elisha, go there. This widow is there. First of all, God, send me to me and don't send me to a widow. He said, this widow will take care of you. And if you look at that verse, it tells us in the 14th verse that Elisha got there. And when he got there, he saw a woman gathering sticks. And God said, I command blessings. Let me show you some ways God commands blessings in your life. I already told you, God will set apart blessings. But if you go to Deuteronomy 28, it talks to us about this God who is more than enough. This God who always supplies more than we need. In Deuteronomy 28, it says, now it shall come to pass that if you hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord your God and do all the commandments which I command you this day, that the Lord shall set you on high above all nations, and he shall make all these blessings come on you. There it is again. Soon as you trust God, here's what I need you to see. Quit worrying and struggling. God has set apart the very blessings that you need. He said, you'll be blessed in the city. You'll be blessed in the field. He said, the blessings are going to overtake you. Here's all I want somebody to know. How many know that sometimes we look around, we are walking blessings? The first thing I want you to know about how God commands blessings is you have become a walking blessing. Come on. You might as well admit it. There was a time you looked around. You don't know how you got from here to there. But every time you turned around, wasn't God right there holding you up? You thought you were done. You thought it was over. And God said, don't worry. I got another blessing hidden in the corner. I just prepared for you. And God said, I'm going to make you a walking blessing. You don't believe me? Look at verse 8. In verse 8 of that text, he said, not only will the Lord command a blessing on you, he said, it'll be in your storehouses, and everything you set your hand on will be blessed. There are many of you in here who can testify right now, I do not know, but every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. When I think back to some of the stuff I've overcome and some of our forefathers has overcome. Think about some second-class citizenship, disrespected, unfair wages, unfair treatment in society, and yet these same people that we can look at didn't worry about what was going on because they had their faith and their trust in God. They had some expectation. I used to hear old folks sing this song. I didn't know it when I was younger, but they said, this morning when I rose up, I didn't have no doubt. This morning when I got out of my bed, I didn't have no doubt. I felt like walking, felt like talking, felt like singing, felt like shouting. You know why they did that? Because the next part says, because I know the Lord will take care of me. I know the Lord will provide me, lead and guide me all the way. Oh, somebody out there ought to understand you ain't going under. You're not going under. You are a walking blessing because God has commanded the blessing on you. Not only will God give walking blessings, he will give open window blessings. Go to Malachi verse 3. It says, will a man rob God? And you say, how have I robbed God? He said, no, if you bring all the tithes and offerings into the storehouse, into my house, he said, I will open up a window and pour you out a blessing that you won't have room to receive. Not only does God make me a walking blessing, have you ever felt like, I don't know where this windfall came from, but God took a certain set of years and set me higher up because I learned that God will open a window. You know what a window is? I found out a window is, I don't even know where the blessing's coming from. But when you've been saved long enough and God has blessed you and touched you long enough, you'll start expecting God to bless you. Are there any expectant people out there that believe it may be dark right now, but I'm just waiting on my window to open because the world is too stressful for me to try to be my own source. But oh, I got a source that has never failed me. I got a source that has always been by my side. You ought to make sure one thing. If you trust God, God said if you give the storehouse into his storehouse, he'll bless your house. Watch this. Here's how the blessing starts for open window blessing. He said if you give support, if you use your money right. He didn't just talk about money, but here he's talking about money that supports the church, money to pay your tithe, money to understand you supporting the work of God, caring about other people. And long as money does not become your God, that's the problem. God can't give some of us the things we need because they become gods in our life and we forget about the God, the one who should get the praise and get the glory and honor for what he's done. What am I talking about? Dr. King, I was watching a documentary, and as he was coming down to the last part of his life, the documentary was called King in the Wilderness. There he was with Harry Belafonte and Andrew Young and Jesse Jackson and his inner cohorts. They were all watching as he slowly began to deteriorate. That's right, I was shocked when I saw how the pressure got to Dr. King, how Dr. King had been so far down because of the death threats he got every day with him and his family, because it seemed like there was always negative headlines that he had to face. I thought Dr. King was immutable. I thought he didn't know anything about this, but the documentary showed the time that he was so stressed, he developed a tic. That's right. He developed a tic. They started noticing when he spoke that he could hardly get the words out. There would be emotion where his head would move and he had a hesitation like he wasn't thinking about it. He couldn't get the words processed soon enough. And they all began to pray with him, saying, why don't you take a break? And Dr. King said, no, I got to do the work of God. Well, they noticed, watch this, y'all, that after a while, the tic was gone. And they asked Dr. King, was Harry Belafonte, they asked him, he said, where did the tick go? He said, I got rid of it. And they said, well, how do you get rid of the tick? He said, I resolved two of the main problems in life. He said, some of those headlines said that I would take the money that was given for the movement and use it myself. And that had me worried. He said, you know what I did? I sat down one night and I satisfied my relationship with money. Money gonna be used, but money will not be my God. He said, once I settled my relationship with money, he said, then I settled my relationship with debt. Death had me worried. He said, but once I got money in its right place and death in its right place, I got help from God. He said, once I understood that the only source I gotta praise, the only source that I know has always been faithful, the only source that has never let me down, that's the one I'm gonna trust. I can get a whole lot of stuff. Dr. King said, but y'all might as well keep your stuff. I've seen the face of God, and he has healed me and blessed me and touched me. And Dr. King found himself where some of us need to be. And so right now we need to understand that God commands the blessing. He
gives us an open window blessing. He makes us a walking blessing. I don't know about you, but I'm claiming that walking blessing thing because I know he kept me all these years. And then he says, here is three ways God commands blessings in your life. I need you to write this down. It's right there in the text. This woman was a Gentile, had nothing to do with God. But God does a setup, he does a restoration, and he does a new thing. Look at verse 10 and 11 in the text. It says, go get me some bread and water. That woman must have frowned her face up and said, you know there's a famine on? I know you're the man of God, but I don't have that kind of, I don't have that. And he said, no, make mine first. And somehow, this woman did it, and she walked right into the setup God does. Let me tell you about the setup. The setup is God puts you in a position where the only way you can reach the blessing or get out of what you're in, you don't have the strength, you don't have the knowledge, you don't have the direction. What God does is put you in a place where you got to seek his face, face to face, and along that process of the setup, God then says, you say to yourself, this is unreasonable what God is asking of me. And then God said, but if you have faith, you can comply. What am I talking about with the setup? Joseph had a dream that what God had said to him was going to come to pass. But Joseph was set up. How was he set up? God allowed him to go into a pit. God allowed him to go to Potiphar's house. God allowed him to go to the prison. And yet, at the end of that setup, Joseph said, wow, I trusted God for all of that. And you know what he said? What you meant for my evil, God turned around for my good. Somebody better hear me. God turns around bad stuff and turns around for your good. What is the restoration? I gotta move on this quickly, y'all. The restoration is Job chapter 42. After you go through a period of suffering, oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Somebody's there right now. Things are falling apart. I don't know why I'm hearing this in my spirit. Things are not going the way you want. You're sitting there wondering if you have a future. You're wondering, how am I going to get this back? It's filtrated into your house and your children and your stuff. And here's what it said in the 42nd chapter, verse 10. The Bible said, after Job prayed for his friends, the Lord restored everything Job has lost, and he had twice as much. Listen to me, y'all. God sets blessings in your life. Every time you go through a trial, what you ought to say is, set up. God, get ready to take me higher. Every time there's something going on in your life that doesn't look good, you ought to say, he will restore it. Don't let anything get in you. And then God said, if you don't see it in Scripture, this messed me up when the Holy Spirit told me this. If you don't see it in Scripture, if it's not something you've seen somebody else have, claim it anyhow. Because in Isaiah chapter 43, verse 18 and 19, here's what God said. Don't remember the former things. Don't remember the stuff that didn't go through. Don't remember the stuff that didn't work in your life. He said, behold, I'm getting ready to do a new thing. Oh, I don't know about you, but every now and then, you ought to claim a new thing in God. You might say, God, I ain't never seen nobody get blessed like that. God said, get on your knees anyhow. I will do a new thing in your life. He said, I'm going to make a way in the wilderness and a river in the desert. I don't have time. Did you hear that? God said, I take the driest places of your life to send you a new thing. I take the places of your life where you can't function to make sure that you understand I just gave you a setup in your blessing. What am I talking about? He said, a setup happens when you are, it says when God commands the blessing, it's because of your setup, it's because of your restoration, and it's because God will do a new thing. Let's go to the second point. Not only is there divine blessing, there's divine calculation. Look at verse 13. And Elijah says, do not fear. And go make me a cake first, he said, and afterward make some for yourself. The woman started thinking, how could I make some for myself afterward when I only got a little bit of oil enough? But the Bible said she went away and did what Elijah said. Here's what I need you to know also about the God who is more than enough. He doesn't calculate and count the blessings like you and I do. I don't know if you heard this, but something powerful just happened in this text. That woman found herself in a position where she had to trust a God she had just heard about, had to turn her life around. Can I stop there? Some of y'all need to learn how to trust God, because God doesn't calculate the way you calculate. You're sitting there all in your mind, all small, talking about how can this work out? How am I going to get out of this? And God is up in heaven saying, turn to me. Just trust me for a moment. And watch what I do. Let me tell you what God does when you understand. He calculates. He can take nothing and make something out of it. He can take a little bit and take you to a big place of blessing. How do I know that? Remember when David went to fight Goliath? Do you remember the fact that David trusted God, but he picked up 5 stones? I believe David got a whole lot more faith after he saw all it took was 1 stone to go into Goliath's head and Goliath fell. Sometimes we're thinking, I may have to fight my way out. God said, no, it might just take 1 praise. It might just take 1 more prayer. Can somebody give God 1 more prayer? It might just take 1 more believing for the dam breaks through and God gives you the blessing. How do I know that? Jesus had a multitude following him. I used to wonder about this when I saw his 12 disciples, and yet he chose 12 of the most jacked up folk in the world, and he changed the whole world. Now, I'm glad God is not out of the choosing jacked up people business, or you and I wouldn't be here. But he chose 12 people and changed the world around. And his disciples changed the world because he didn't need a crowd. All he needed was 12. And the third thing is, watch this, the disciples were expert fishermen. They were on the boat. And they were, Jesus was asleep in the bottom of the boat. And all of a sudden, the storm was raging. Can you see what I'm talking about? This? Those fishermen, expert professionals, they pulled in the lines. They dropped the gales. They did all the stuff they know how to do. And all that stuff they did no good. Jesus woke up, stepped out on the bow of the boat. Now he said, the spirit of the word, peace, be still. Can I tell you that you need to understand God not only commands divine blessings, but he calculates already what I'm going to need. Man, this should give you some peace. Turn me down just a little bit, please. This should give you some peace because he commands what you need. He said, peace be still. God is better off and bigger than you are. I'll tell you a story about this young boy who went to the store with his mother. And they walked into the candy section of the store. And the store owner saw the young boy's eyes lit up. So he took a big jar of candy and held it down for the little boy to grab some candy out of the barrel. And the little boy put his hand behind his head and said, mm-mm. And his mom smacked him and said, why are you so rude? And the man put the candy back there again. And the boy was going to put his hand up and drew it back again. His mom said, the man said, don't worry. He reached in and grabbed the boy a handful of candy. And they got in the car. The mom said, I've never been so embarrassed. Why did you do that to me? What was wrong with you? He said, Mom, I know what I was doing. I wanted him to grab the candy. His hands are bigger than mine. I knew he could give me what I needed. Oh, come on. Y'all just said something. God's hands are bigger than yours. When you're calculating, God can reach down in 1 swoop and know what you need. That's why he can meet every need. God said, my hands are bigger. You can trust me. How do we show God we trust him? Elisha told her, make mine first. Matthew 6:33. I know we know this. And y'all say, have to be preaching stuff that I already know. Do we? Isn't there sometimes when we forget to put God first? Maybe it's a little thing to put God first, but then there's some other times in our life where we've tried everything else before we put God there. Come on, be honest. I know I have. And then all of a sudden God woke me up and shook me and said, hey, what about me? We've been there. But Matthew 6:33 says, seek you first the kingdom of God, and everything else will follow. What am I talking about? Steve Covey, in his book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, said this. He said, and I love this statement. He said, the main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. That's the main thing. Did you get that? Here's what God is saying. Sometimes we can get caught up in stuff that's on periphery. We can get caught up in stuff that's not designed to bless us. And then we don't get the main thing where God wants us to get it. So all of a sudden, God said, look, when stuff is falling apart, go back to the main thing. How did you get here? When life is not like you want it, go back to the main thing. The main thing is your relationship with me and the power I have. Where are these, this, that, for? So follow me right here. And not only that, if you want to understand how God calculates, he told her, he said, make mine first. The woman walked to the kitchen. I don't know what she felt, but can you see her? Probably shaking her head as she poured the, reached in the barrel and got that little bit of meal and poured that last drop of oil and looked at her hungry son over there. Oh, y'all got to feel this. This was not a little thing she did. and her hungry son over there, she already made a stranger a cake first because he said God gonna supply your needs. But you gotta understand something. He said, make mine first. She did. And the text says the barrel never ran out. What happened? Here is the secret to life. Here is the secret to all blessings. Here is the foundation of everything you have. Giving starts the blessing. Whatever you want in life, you have to give first. Come on, there's a lot of people who are sitting out there miserable. You're sitting out there bitter. You're sitting out there with lack. You're sitting out there without things. And the problem is, Luke 6:38 tells us, give, and it shall be given. But look what I tell you about the God who's more than enough. Good measure. God's calculation. Press down. Shake it together. Run it over. I said, God, how come I give you this much and you give me back that much? He said, because I'm the God of more than enough. If you trust me, man, you're going to see some blessings running after you. Because every time you trust me, I give you more than enough. Giving is at the heart of God, for God so loved that he gave. If God told us the only way for the redemption plan to work was to give his only son, how come you can't understand I gotta sacrifice something in order to get my blessing? Everything God touches blesses us because we made up our mind that when all is over, when all is said and done, I'm still gonna trust God. Watch this. Here's the miracle. She poured more oil. She went more meal. Never runs out. Never stop. There's a power that never runs out and never stops. The last point. Once you understand God commands the blessing, once you understand that God has a divine calculation, a divine command of blessings, last thing is there's some divine celebration. I'm going to close right here. Because this you know, it showed me how Elijah gave us a pattern of these principles of provision. It says in verse 17, after all of this blessing, here's what I want you to know. Celebration comes from a testimony. Celebration comes from a reason to be joyful. Yes, we got a reason to be joyful by being part of God's family, but what I'm saying is, as soon as this woman got her blessing, I'm only trying to teach y'all, hold on. It said the son she loved, who she was trying to save in the first place, she went to Elisha and said, Elisha, did you come to bring misery into my house? Sometimes it'll look like God. I just held on. I just trusted you. Why in the world did this happen? You don't know? God was setting you up for a divine celebration. And it says, you got to do like this woman did. When she saw that things weren't going right, here's the key. Here's what you got to do. Make sure you keep going to God. I know God looks like God, you know, allowed it to come in. Be mad if you want to, but there's no other place you need to be than on your knees in front of God. Because this woman said, I'm taking my dead son to God, because if anybody can revive him, God can. Did you catch that? Some of y'all got some dead promises, some dead wishes, some dead desires. What you need to do is remember, they didn't die so you couldn't get blessed. They died so God could teach you how to hold on and have a divine celebration. He wanted you to know that I'm always more than enough. What happened next? Elijah said, give me the boy. Now watch this, y'all. This will mess you up. Elijah took the child. First of all, if the mother was so adamant that she wasn't going to trust God anymore, she wouldn't have gave her child up. So I'm letting you know, do like this woman did. She was mad, but she still went to God. And when she got her child in Elisha's arms, the Bible said Elisha took the child upstairs and he called on God because he knew God was the God of more than enough. This was a resuscitation, not a resurrection. I don't have time to tell you the biblical difference, but there's really only been one resurrection. Everything else in the Bible was a resuscitation because people died again. But I want you to know, Elisha went up there and he trusted God. Because watch what he did. He laid across the boy three times. The number three in the Bible is the number of resurrecting a promise. Resurrecting God's faith. What do I mean by that? Because when Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane, he prayed three times. When he hung on the cross, it was the third hour.
When he went to, when he got in the grave, he rose in 3 days. What I'm trying to tell you is, if you can get yourself to keep trusting God at least 3 times, somebody better hear this, God's power kicks in. If you got something that's stuck, I dare you to start praising. When you get done with that praise, give him another one. When you get done with that praise, give him another one. Pretty soon your heart will change. The anointing will start flowing. And all of a sudden, when Elisha got off of this boy, after the third time, he found out that the boy was alive. Took the boy back to his son. Took the boy back to his mother. And when his mother got his child, she looked up. Watch this, y'all. Hear the celebration. And she said, now I know. Man, that is the best celebration you can have. You don't need no preacher. You don't need anybody else to affirm. You got a now I know attitude in your house. How many know when something happens, you can just say, now I know God is able. Now I know my God will do it. How do you know? Because when I look back and I remember where God brought me from, I know God is able to bless me and bring me out. She said, now I know that you're a man of God. Because not only did you supply my needs, not only did you not let the oil run out and the meal run out, you blessed my son and brought him back. God, I'm sorry. My son could have died and I didn't have you. Thank you, Father. That'll make you celebrate the worst moment in your life. Because when you celebrate your faith in the God who has more than enough, he will come through for you. I'm talking to somebody out there. God will break every chain. He will bring back every desire. He will restore your life. Elisha had enough strength after this, being fed by the ravens, down by the brook, all of that. But the next chapter, I don't have time, he marched in and said, if God be God, serve him. All I'm saying, there's some of you out there, I know I gotta quit. There's some of you out there that are telling me, Pastor, I know what you're talking about. I just want to grab people and push God in them to let them know, try this God. He's never let me down. He's never failed me. I thank God today for the God who is more than enough. I mean, led to pray for somebody out there, because you were at that point with that widow. You were begging. You thought, my job's gone, my unemployment's run out, this is going on. God said, don't worry, make me first, trust me first, and watch, whatever you need will be supplied and it will never ever run out. Well, thank God for you joining us today. I feel the anointing has transcended from this camera into where you are right now. So if you could do this for me, I believe you need to begin celebrating right now. Telling yourself, I got the answer to my prayer. Go ahead, don't be ashamed. I don't know who's in the house with you. You ought to celebrate, saying there's a God who has made available to me all he has, and that's all I need. Let's pray. If you're not saved, pray this prayer with me today. You need to walk in the shoes of this God who is more than enough. Father God, I thank you for the people that are about to say this prayer. This was designed as a place where you commanded the blessing of a changed life. Amen. Now say these words with me. Say, Lord God, I thank you for thinking about me, for knowing, God, that I was at the end and needed some help. I believe you died for my sins and rose again with all power in your hand. Because I believe it, I am saved. God bless you. This is Pastor Duncan saying, remember, he is the God of more than enough. Let this pandemic come, let all the virus in the world come. I don't have to worry. What I have will never run out. Don't forget to, if you want to give to this ministry, go to our website. There's 4 ways to give. You can give through Givelify if you have that app. You can go to PayPal and give.
just go online, go to www.shilohbaptistchurches.org, www.shilohbaptistchurches.org. You can give, you can mail it in when you go in, you can see where you can mail. And then for our members, we have, if you're in the area, you ride by our churches, there's identifiable slots where you can just, not even get out your car, just drop it right through the slot. We love you. This ministry is moving. Go to our website and check like. Go to our YouTube channel and subscribe. Help us carry the word of God. This Pastor Duncan saying thank you. You didn't have to be with us. Thank you today. Have a blessed week.
Take it to him and leave it there.
I was down with a no way up, and I needed some help. Everybody breathing but not living, just existing. Well, and I needed some help. Somebody told me that Jesus will set you free. I tried it for myself, and now I know what he did.